Right. So let me close all these files first. This is the framework on which we are working. Okay. Cucumber API automation. What we're trying to do is we're trying to automate API via Cucumber. These are your scenarios. Okay, what are scenarios? You write your test cases in scenarios. This is the keyword which you write. Let me make it bigger. Okay, this is a scenario name. When you write given, it's a statement. You can write when, again a statement. These statements actually represents your requirement. Okay, you have few tags in Cucumber called as given, when, then. Now there is one more tag called as and. However, there are few more tags available like but and all. But most importantly, you use given, when, then, and to some extent. If this and is written after then, it makes it then. So if you go and see the step definition for this file, you will see it will be annotated as then. Okay, how to go to this line? So every line which you see here is associated with a method, right? So this Gherkin, what you see here is in a Gherkin syntax. Gherkin syntax has these keywords. Okay, scenario, given, when, then, and, right? Now whatever you write in this syntax in Cucumber, there's a mechanism to associate your statements, English statements, with the methods. We call those methods as step definitions. So these are your steps. This is called a step, and its corresponding method is called as definition. So step definition. Okay, I can directly go from here to the step definition. Now, where is step definition? Step definition is like a method. Method in Java always will reside inside a class. So I have created a class called as step def fetch products or step def get scenario. Right. Now don't have this misunderstanding that each feature file will have one step definition. It's not that, right? It is not related. You can have a scenario or situation wherein this definition of this step is present in one class, definition of this is present in another step definition class. So you can divide it that way, based on your understanding of how you wish to create your framework. Okay, but never kind of misunderstand this, that every feature file will have one step definition file. No. Yes, for the sake of simplicity, if you want to make things simple, then you can kind of keep everything in the same step definition files. For a small project, now for example, this is a small project. Now, small project means you have 30, 40 step definition methods, not more than that. Then you can afford to put this inside single step definition class file. But when you have huge project, where a lot of methods and annotations and step definitions are present, then it's not advisable to keep everything in a single file. You have to break it on a logical ground. The way we break page object model, right? Why we have page object model file in Selenium or in Selenium framework? Because we want to divide it properly. We don't want to keep everything in a single file. Same concept will apply here. If you're putting all the methods in a single step definition file, it will become brittle, difficult to manage. You will not find what methods are where, right? So it's good practice not to keep everything in a single file. That's one concept. Okay. Second thing is here is once you write this. Okay. So first of all, what we do is we write the feature. We write the feature. We don't write step definition immediately. We first define the requirements. Normally in a BDD environment, if you are having a BDD like behavior driven development environment, in that case, first the BA will write the requirement in this format. This format will then be sent to developer. It will also send to tester, and they will start writing their code and they will start binding their code methods with these requirements. That is typically BDD. What we are doing here is not BDD. Getting a difference between what we are doing and what is BDD. This is not BDD. BDD is where developer is also there, tester is also there, and requirements coming from BA, and BA is actually giving the writing requirements in Gherkin, and then Gherkin syntax you are fetching, giving to dev, dev is writing code, tester writing code. There's no dev here. all we have is testers. They're like us. So it's a single leg which we are kind of leveraging here, right? So we are using Cucumber. Why? Because we want to make our test cases in such a manner so that it becomes readable for the whoever is reading it and becomes easy to write as well, right? Got it? So what we are doing right now, we are using Cucumber, but we are not doing VDD. So again, don't make this mistake. This is a misunderstanding, common misunderstanding. That yes, I am using Cucumber framework, so that means I am doing VDD. No, it's not the case. Got it? Clear? This is a simple example of a Cucumber framework, Cucumber automation framework. So when someone says what you are doing, I am automating our test cases API using Cucumber, but I am not doing VDD. Okay. Second thing is, once now who is writing this? Most probably a BA is writing this in your project, but you can say BA is writing their requirement in a Jira in some format of this sort, and then we are taking that format and we are modifying it based on our own needs, our own automation needs, so that it becomes you are giving it a form of a test case. Actually, this is a test case only, right? A test case is like a prerequisite. When a search product is something, and when I do this, then what happens? Like this is a test case, right? In test case, you have something is there, that is a prerequisite. When you do something, something should happen. That's a test case, right? So now you are writing these test cases based on the requirements which you're getting from BA. BA might be giving you requirements in this exact same format or in a plain English format, which you are converting, or he is giving it in this format, but it's not very readable. So you're modifying something and keeping this in some format so that it becomes usable for your testing framework. Okay. Are you able to understand what I'm trying to say? Huh? Not confused, right? Or confused. No. So the point is, how can you write this test case if there's no requirement? The requirement has to be there. Who is giving you the requirement? A BA. Right? A BA is giving you the requirement. Now you have to write test cases. Now here are two ways you can write test cases. Either you will write an Excel file and then convert that into a code, or keep it there. Create your test cases like this in a dot feature file and then write a code for it. Right? Previously, when this was not there, what we used to do is there was an Excel file or a test management tool or any other tool where you're keeping your writing your test cases in a plain tabular format. Right? And then by reading those test cases, you are automating it in your script, Eclipse or Java. Here we are also doing the same thing. It just the test cases are now not in a Excel file, they are now in dot feature file. And your code is also there in Java, and both are related, associated. That's the advantage which you are getting here if you are using Cucumber. So you have this mapping of test case steps with the actual thing which the code is doing. Getting it? This is the only advantage what you are getting as of now if you are not using VDD approach. What if this is not VDD, not neither TDD? This is a plain Cucumber API, Cucumber automation framework. Advantage of using this is anyone who wishes to see what the test case is doing, he can easily read it and he will understand what's happening. First advantage. Second advantage, if there is a change in the requirement, if something is being changed in this feature file, it has to be changed. The change has to cascade to the test case as well, right? Putting this into contrast with the previous approach, wherein you had test cases in Excel file or a test management tool and code in Eclipse or GitHub, if you're making a change in the tabular format, will it impact the test case? No. No one will know what change has happened, right? So this, there are two advantages. One is mapping. It has one-to-one mapping with the what are the things which framework is doing based on requirement. Second is readable format. That's the only two advantage which you're getting here. Okay. Now, once you have written this, then what you have to do is, by the way, we are using a Maven project, right? So Maven, we keep our feature files inside resources, right? Now, this Cucumber was built in Ruby, right? It was originally created in Ruby. Then they started giving different language bindings as well. So the version which we are using here is Cucumber JVM for Java. So Cucumber has different bindings. So Cucumber has different library for .NET, for Java, for Python, like different libraries are there. But in our case, we are using Cucumber with JVM, okay? Now, when we run this, when you try to run this feature file, it will start looking for the step definition files, right? Now, where it will go and look for the step definition files? How will we tell Cucumber where to look it? So by default, Cucumber start looking for the step definition files in the same folder. So what will it do? It will start finding it here in the Best Buy API folder only. But it will not find it. Because that's not how we keep things in Java. We have proper segregation. Now Cucumber says if you are not keeping your step definition files in the same folder, then you need to specify. How would I know where you have kept it, right? For that, it gives you a mechanism called as Cucumber options. Okay? Cucumber options is a way by which you can tell Cucumber what is kept where, how to, where are feature files, where are step definition files, what kind of reports you would need, what kind of tags you would run or you would want to execute, and few more details as well. Okay, now where we need to do that? So what we do is, now Cucumber by itself cannot be executed. Unless I'm just putting things very simply, it cannot execute by itself. It needs a runner, something which will trigger its execution, right? So when it comes to Java, it takes help from JUnit. So what happens is Cucumber says, create a class, call it as a runner. In that class, create, don't write anything in the class, but at top of it, give an annotation called as run with. @runwith, that is a JUnit annotation. So I'm instructing JUnit runner to execute this file using Cucumber, right? So where I do that? So I am creating a runner called as Cucumber test. Okay. This is a Cucumber test. On top of it, I have written run with. Getting it? So see, the class file is empty. Or rather, let me just create it from scratch so that you know what to do. And I want you to write it down rather than copy and paste it. Okay, try to write it. See what's happening there. Give, take a reference, but type it up. So I'll say my new test. Okay. I don't need a constructor. It will be an empty class. Okay. On top of it, I'm going to write run with. This run with is an annotation of JUnit. Okay. Okay. So run with is there. Now it will ask for the what? Right, as I said, I am instructing Cucumber, sorry, I am instructing JUnit to run this class with Cucumber API. Getting it? As I said, Cucumber is kind of, I'm again saying, I'm putting this simply. There's more to this concept. But what I'm trying to say is, I'm taking help of JUnit to trigger the execution via Cucumber runner. Right, to trigger the execution via Cucumber, I need to do this. So run with is an annotation of JUnit, and this is import. Right, there's one more concept here which I'll, let's not discuss it as of now, but just keep it this way. Second is, now Cucumber will say, okay, I will execute this, but it doesn't know where are the feature files, where are the step definition files. So first and foremost, I need to mention it. So I'll make use of Cucumber options. Okay. Inside this, I'll start giving some values. So there are two most important arguments, which are, one is features is equal to, then comma. Second is glue, comma. And third is plugin. Okay, there's one more called as dryer. Monochrome is okay as of now. Let's leave it for now. But this much is the most important items. Okay, in features we need to mention where are the feature files. So I'll give it like this: class path. So don't write this like source, test, resources, feature, best buy. Okay, the reason we are not giving values like this, like you can give like this: src dot test dot resources dot, like, right? You can give like this. These are actual folder structure, but I will ask not to do this. Why? Because we can give that as well, but we will use class path. Class path is where all your libraries class files are getting saved. Okay, usually when you run via Maven, right, it everything happens inside target folder. So by default, when you just compile this, right, it will, all the feature file, all the resources files gets copied in that folder, as well as with all the compile code and class files compilation, everything will be stored there. So I'm going to use class path. So I'll say once the execution, before the execution happens, you need to find these feature files inside class path, right? And I will not use this source test resource. I'll say inside features, go to best buy, right? So I'll say something like this: features slash best buy API. Either I'll only stop here. So what will happen? It will take run all the feature files, right? If I want to run only specific feature file, I can mention the specific feature file as well. So I'll say API health check or something like this. Got it? Second is glue. Glue is where your step definition files are kept. So I have kept all my step definition files inside product.bestbuy API.step definition. So here I'm going to directly put it. So product best buy API step defs. So I have kind of glued features with the step definition file, right? Once I do this, now as of now, let's do one thing. I'm going to comment this, okay? Or rather, let me delete it. I'm deleting this. Delete. Right? So I have written this class definition files yesterday. Okay. Right. The reason they are coming in yellow is the step definition files are not present. It's not able to locate it. Yeah. Is it? Okay. Just sit. Getting it? Okay. So reason this is coming as yellow is it's not able to find it. So I'm at a very level one, where I have just received the requirements and I have just started writing the test cases, right? I'm at level one. Okay. Now, next thing which I want to do is to generate the step definition file, because each file should be pointing to a step definition. How to do that? I will have to run it. So Cucumber gives this feature as well. If the step definition file is not there, it will generate it for you. Okay. And before I do that, I need to create this. This file. Right. So now I am telling Cucumber options features file is there. Glue is there, but it's actually not there because step definition files are not there. Plugin I've kept as it is as of now. And dry run as true. Dry run means I don't want to execute it. I just want to see if step definition files are there. If it's there, that's fine. If it's not there, then generate it. Right? For that reason, I'm doing dry run as true. So I'm not actually running it. It's just a dry run. Okay? So what I'll do is, how will I run this? I have just now created this. Right? So here I will write get scenario dot feature. Okay, that's it. Now I can just directly go here and click on run. Run as JUnit test. As I said, JUnit is assisting Cucumber. Cucumber cannot directly be executed. It needs JUnit to trigger itself. Not itself. It needs JUnit to trigger Cucumber, right? So I'm doing this. It's failed. Initialize action. Could not load plugin class. Okay. So I cannot leave this empty actually. And as of now, comment this. Okay. Now let me run this again. Right. So if you see here, it executed and it was not able to find the step definition of these files, and that's the reason it generated. Okay. And if you also notice, it has intelligently generated it. How? So if I go and have a look here, I have actually written these statements sort of intelligently. Why I'm saying this? So I'm writing something like this. See, I'm saying get all products sort by highest price. I'm writing best by API is up and running. There are no arguments in this. This state plain statement. I hit URL with query parameter as, and here I have put this into double quotes. This is how in Gherkin you tell the Cucumber that whatever is present inside these double quotes is an argument. That is, in Gherkin, there is a mechanism to send an argument to the step definition. Right? So from English statement, you are passing a value to a code that is allowed in Cucumber, right? And that's how I have written these. So that if I want to change it later on, the same step definition file will work for me. So this is how I'm bringing reusability in my code. Got it? Same way I've done for here, 200. So if there's a 200, that's an integer value, it will understand it as a argument. An integer argument, double quotes, string, integer, directly it will take it. So you will see here one, right? You will see here, like this is argument, this is an argument. So what I'm saying is get products that are either between 99 and 1.99, right? So I've written here condition as this. And here I have put this as an argument again. Why I'm doing this? Because if I want to check whether instead of these values, I want to check between 2 and 3, I can still use the same statement. It should work. For 2 and 3, I should not be copying it again and writing new statements. No. Are you getting what I'm trying to say? So I am parameterizing it. So this is also a, you can say, an artwork. You have to write your requirements intelligently. You cannot just keep on writing things and, you know, generating the statements again and again. That will be a duplication. Right? You should not be doing it. You should need to understand. So in this case, I'll try to explain this. The get products that are either between 99 and 1.99, right? So I'm putting a condition here, 0.99, 1.99. Let's say I want to have another test case where I want to do this. Instead of this, I want to say $5 and $6, right? So right now I'm only going to change the arguments, $5, $6. $5, $6. Okay. And the same statement should still work. That is what I mean by parameterization. Are you getting what I'm saying? Right. It's something similar to TestNG, where from external file we send parameters, and based on that parameter, the same test case can be reused. Same concept here. Statement is there. I have parameterized it. Different value will result in different behavior of the same method. Got it? You can use examples. Yes, why not? You can use examples, but the concept will remain same. Examples are used if you want to run the same test case with multiple data. Yes, in this case I could have used examples as well, right? But that's not what I'm focusing on. I'm focusing on parameterization. If you're using examples as well, then also you have to parameterize it in a different sense, but parameterization will have to be there. How you're implementing, different story. What I'm saying is you need to learn how to utilize an existing step so that you don't need to write it again and again and again.
Right. जैसे हम सिलेनियम में जब पैरामीटराइजेशन करते हैं तो जब पैरामीटर पास करते हैं लिंक अप टू द एक्सएमएल सेक्शंस, जैसे अपन एक्सएमएल फाइल में जो हार्ड कोडेड डेटा रहता है वो अपन एग्जीक्यूशन इधर अपना जो पैरामीटराइजेशन करते हैं उसमें अपन जो पैरामीटर पास करते हैं उसकी वैल्यू अपन एक्सएमएल सेक्शन में एक
राइट
और वो जो अपने टेम्पलेट फाइल है वो एग्जीक्यूट करते हैं
राइट
जैसे कि वो सिलेनियम में लिंक अप होता है
राइट
एक्चुअली सर बीडीबी में कैसा होता है इसमें कोकम में कैसा होता
है सो यू आर टॉकिंग अबाउट टेस्ट एनजी राइट हां
यस
Test ng XML you are talking about, right?
Yes.
So when you have a test ng XML file, okay, that's your driver file, right? In some sense, from there you have an option to pass a parameter to your test, right? Here there is no XML essence. Here you have feature file. From feature file you have plain English statements. From plain English statements you can pass value to the parameter to the your code. So the concept of parameterization is still the same. The implementation of it has been changed. From here, that's how you have sent parameters. From TestNG, this is not there in TestNG, right? In TestNG, you have XML. So you pass things from XML. Here, you don't have XML. You have feature file. So you pass arguments from feature file. In both the cases, you are doing a parameterization.
The requirement to our parameterization karna kaam thoda tha feature file mein add karte
hain. Yes. Yes, you can. But he not here. You can pass Excel path name here. You fetch it from there. But that sometimes not a very good design. If you are putting Excel file there, your requirement cannot be 100% read from a feature file. What you have written in Excel file, the end user will have to go and open the Excel file to see what happened. So always advisable to keep everything in a feature file. So that dependencies will be reduced. Right. So lot of people do this. It's not that people doesn't do it. I have seen people doing it, but that's not considered a good cucumber design. In, when you talk about good cucumber design, things has to be part of a feature file. So that end customer, the person who is use reading it and someone who is going to amend it, will easily understand it. The purpose of having this is so that the user it becomes easy for the user. Right, if you have more dependencies, things might become more tricky. Right, always good to have everything in a feature file. That's my understanding of it as of now. Perhaps it would change later, but I have tried Excel files, but that was messy. Later on, people get difficulty in understanding it because when you design something, it becomes easy for you. But you have to take this in mind. When I design it, it is easy for me, but would this be easy for a person who is reading it for the first time? Will it make sense to him? So you have to keep this principle in head. Getting it? That's something called as design principles. Okay. Yeah. Line number 70.
So this is the conversion of the actual.
No. So this is a plain English text.
Okay.
It has no meaning. It has no binding to the code. So you can write anything here. But this is what is relevant.
This is the actual parameter.
This is the actual parameter.
And as what if I'll have to add the status code as in 400.
You can say 400 here.
I can parameterize it.
That's parameterization. What I've done just now is parameterization, right? I can do 300.
It's like for integer, we don't have to put double.
Yes. It's something like that. If an integer, you directly put as integer, and if it's string, you put in double quotes. It's like that. Okay.
So whatever is displayed over there in green.
Yes, will be treated as a parameter. Be treated as a parameter. Okay. Now, why I jumped into this concept? Because I just ran it, and when I run it, I got to see this implementation here. Okay, getting it? Hey, I'll talk to you later. Huh? Just sit and see what I'm doing. Got it? So if you see here, wherever there was parameter, you see Cucumber has intelligently replaced it with int. And provided an argument here. That means whatever we're going to pass from there will be sent here, and you can use it in your code. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy these. Copy. I'll go back and I'll go and create a step definition file here. So I'll give it a name as class step defs. I can give any name, but always try to give something sensible. Okay. So I've given get requests. So like all the get request related test cases steps will be part of the step definition. I've kept it this way. People also can, you know, sometimes structure it based on given when then. Like all the given statement will be in step def given. All the when statement will be in step def when. You can also keep it this way. And we need to learn how to do that as well. Okay. So I'll double click on it. And I've created this. As of now, I don't need the constructor. So I'll remove this and I'll paste it here. Okay. So if you see here, I was saying this, right? So even the end statement, since it's written after then, so it will be treated as a then. Okay. So I will have to remove these errors. It's cucumber.api.java.en. Okay, one more important thing here. So if you go and see POM, so I have started using Cucumber. In the first class, I explained the significance of POM file, right? So in this POM file, this is a POM file, right? In the POM file, I have entered some dependencies. If these dependencies are not there, I will not be able to use Cucumber, right? So I added io cucumber, cucumber.java, Cucumber JUnit implementation, and JUnit itself. Okay. And there's one more called as Cucumber Picometer, which I will explain later. It's a dependency injection framework, which is very, very important. But we'll see it maybe later part of the session today. Okay. But what I'm telling you here is cucumber.version. Right now I'm using Cucumber version 4.2.0. Cucumber 4. It's also called as Cucumber 4. It has many new features. Okay. But if you go and make this 4.7.0, okay, there is a slight change there. So what changed there is, if I'm here and if you go and see at the top, if I'm doing this, I'm doing cucumber.api.java.en is what I'm getting. If you change it to 4.7.0, like Cucumber version 4.7, you will not see cucumber.api.java. You will see, I think, io.cucumber. Something like that. So don't get confused. Okay. And I will recommend use 4.2.0 only for the sake of simplicity. Right. This will be there, but it will be marked as deprecated. Something like that. A line will be stretched across it. And it means deprecated, that there people should resist from using it. Right. Then when. Hey, I'm recording it or not? Then the then part, all the issues are now resolved. So now your step definition files is ready. Now you can actually go and write the code inside these files. So far so good? Right. So understood the significance of runner test? Understood?
How to save the path for each
class path? Write class path. Colon, then features. So inside source test resources, I have a folder called as features. So I'll start with features. Class path it will take by default, because the thing is when you compile, when the Maven or Eclipse compile the code, it saves these files in the bin folder. That becomes your class path. Like all the class files, compiled classes will be there and will fetch it directly from features. So you can actually see that. You can actually see this when you run it. So before running, Eclipse compiles it, right? Compilation, all the compile code goes inside bin folder of your Active workspace. Inside this, you will see this folder structure, and all the resources file also gets copied there. And in Maven also, same thing happens. Okay, inside target folder.
What if we are not keeping the feature file folder resources? Although it is a good practice, but yeah. We have kept in some other, like a test or name. So, they have to write it as a class path?
I think yes. I think whatever is the non-Java resource files in the Eclipse Java structure, compiler always copies them. You know, just common sense is telling me this. I haven't tried it. Most probably this should happen. This should work then also. You can still try it out. Okay? But the idea is, wherever the feature files are present, it has to be Cucumber. We have to tell Cucumber that where are the feature files, where are the step definitions. If you're not telling it, Cucumber will not find it automatically. It tries to find in the same folder, but that's it. If it doesn't find it in the same folder, it will escape it. Okay. Second concept here is, now the actual thing will come. Okay. So see, I have written the step definition files, but still it is not able to find it. Why? So we need to refresh it. Eclipse is not very intelligent. Actually, Eclipse is not very intelligent. It's IntelliJ, which is very good. But usually it's the community version of IntelliJ is there, but people mostly tend to use Eclipse, which is not as intelligent as IntelliJ. Right? It's done. So now it's done. Now if you want to go to a specific step definition file, press Control and hover on it. It will take you to the step definition file of that state. Got it? Right. Now it is connected. Right. So I have seen people struggling with it and saying, sir, I have written step definition file. Glue is also there, but it's not able to find it. It's yellow is coming. Right. So I've just told you what you have to do. Close all the files, refresh the project, and then open it again. It will be there. Okay. Now, let's start with a simple case. Let me start with the API health check feature file. Let me start with it. Okay. So I have commented all the lines here. I have written something here. And this is separate feature file. So this was like the first test case. Now we'll jump on to API now, as of now, right? Because we want to automate API. So in the last class also I have explained kya kar rahe hai, right? So this is your API. I'm not going to go into detail how to install it. Everyone knows, right? The Best Buy is an API. Let me just show it at least once. This is where it is kept, called the Best Buy API Playground. Instructions to download it is here. You need to do a git clone. So like, for example, you doesn't know, you didn't come last class. Did you come? Okay. So that's how you have to install it. Whoever doesn't know, I think you don't know it. I don't know why, because I tried it on Mac. Yeah, Baba was also saying it's coming, and for you it's working. For our system, it was not working. Perhaps some instruction, it's not, you're not following proper instruction. I don't know why it's not coming, but for 90% of people, it's coming. Right? If it's not working, then maybe we can sit together and try to solve it. Or you can sit together and try to solve it. Okay? But that is important. Without this, you will not be able to automate this API, because if this API works on localhost. Okay? Once I do this, I need to do this npm start. So always, whenever you want to trigger this API, you need to go to the folder, command line, type npm start. That's what I did, right? See, I went to this folder where this is cloned, and I typed npm start, and it started and said, started on localhost 3030. I'll go back. Now there are multiple endpoints. Now again, I'm not going to go into deep depth about what is API or API works. Perhaps we'll talk about rest assured, but not in detail about APIs, okay? So here there are different endpoints, right? So when an API developer develops an API, it is his obligation to tell its user what that API works, what that API is and how that works. Most probably this is called as API documentation, right? So in API documentation, it could have an HTML format, it could have a document, even an email will sometimes be thrown at you and saying this is the API documentation. But in most cases, it would be an HTML page where it will be talking about endpoints. What are endpoints? Endpoint is simple. It's the place where the service is, where the service is listening to the user and it will respond, right? So if I go and click on products, I'm getting this, right? So if you see, this is the base URL or URI. This is the endpoint. So at this endpoint, the service is present, it's responding. So when I say products, it will give me all the products, whatever is present there. So 51960, total number of products, it's what I'm getting. Right? Right now it's telling me only 10 products because by default it has limited it to 10. Okay, so right now it's only giving me 10. That's how API has been created. It's not that all the APIs, that these only these tags will be there. No, it depends on that API and what kind of JSON structure they want it to be. And will they will fetch, fill that JSON file format, JSON fields with the data corresponding to that API or domain, and it will show it to you. So don't kind of memorize this, that this is how all API works. No, okay. I'll go back. Now, for example, I want a specific product. I don't want all. I want a product which has ID as this. So I'm getting only this one. That is how API has been designed. So the developer of this API told us that if you write this slash and write the ID, you will get that specific product. Who is telling me this? The API developer is telling me this. That's how they have designed. It's not that all the APIs in the world will act in the same manner. It's not that. In all probability, this is how they will implement. That's the standard practices. But is it necessary that they will implement this manner? No, it's not necessary. Okay. Second important concept here is. So let me go to right. So these are different. So this API is about e-commerce. E-commerce, you will have products, categories, stores, services, version. These are different endpoints which is it provides. These are 6 endpoints which it provides. Now each endpoint will have different mechanisms to filter out the data. Okay, so product is an endpoint, but this product will accept some parameters from the user in the URL, and based on that it will give you the result. And that is what you need to check, whether the API which has been created and the filters which their developers have provided are working in a right manner, right? And they have given us an example queries, right? So you don't have to actually go and write things on your own. They have given you a few examples. So they say get product with ID as 913-2294. When you do this, you will get that product information. First scenario. So what you have to do is you need to hit it, and then you need to validate that whatever information is coming, is it related to this ID called as 91344? So as soon as you get this JSON, a simple check which you can do is whether the ID in this JSON is coming as what you have provided here. Simple check. One test case. It's way easier than Selenium test case, isn't it? And I don't know why people say API stuff. Okay. Second test case. Get all products. You can find that total. There's a tag called as total, which is coming like this, and you can just check few things, right? Perhaps you can't check whether it has returned all because limit is coming as 10, but this is what you can check. Like total is 51960. In a more integrated environment, you can also put one more validation. You hit this, you'll get total as 51960. Then when you will fire a query in the database, and you will take a count of all the products, and then you will match it, that what JSON is giving you is exactly same what database has, right? This is a very valid scenario. In this case, we don't have a database. However, we have a database in NPM, database will be there. But right now I haven't explored it, how you will fire a query inside this. If you can try this, nothing can better than that. Try it out. Because once the server is started, localhost, there's a server as of now. And there will be a database as well. So you can create a database string and all, and you can fire a query to get all the products. And you will be able to do it. That's my guess. I don't know whether it will work or not. That's my guess. Okay? But if you try this, very good. So impressive.
We are creating a database installation also.
Where?
On the local host, when we are installing the NPM, we are creating a database installation also with all the values.
Right.
Which is created by
NPM. Right, right. It will be there. That's what I'm saying. This localhost is a server created on your machine via Node.js, and the database has to be there because all this information is coming from database. It's not like JSON is, all the JSONs are kept somewhere. It's not that. The data is in database at runtime. APIs firing a query, fetching the results, converting into JSON and sending it to you. That's how all API works. Okay?
While we are testing an API, we are actually testing, there are two scenarios or cases we are testing out. Either we are testing the APIs or the data in the APIs is coming. So what is the first priority we have to test?
Right. So your question is, if we are testing API, you can test two things. Whether API is working or it is giving the right response. So that's different levels, right? First you have to check whether API is working. Second, you need to check the data. Now, if you check the data, first check is will automatically done. So the primary purpose of testing an API is to check whether what API is returning is right or not. If the API is returning something, of course, it has to be working, right? So always you check what API is returning. That's the only check which you can do. That's the whole and sole purpose of APIs, right? Because you don't want that API to return something wrong. Otherwise, there's a defect, big defect. If API is not returning things as expected. All right. Now let's check more scenarios. So they have given you scenarios. Now they're saying, if you hit this and you pass this query parameter, right? So you must have seen in this and other applications also. You hit a URL or you click somewhere, the URL changes and there is a question mark. And after question mark, there are key and value pairs, something like that, right? This is called as query parameters. Not in API terminology, but in all HTTP URLs terminology. If you want to pass some information to the server via URL, you can do it like this. Getting it? Usually in get cases you do. In post cases you never do it. Post is usually used for confidential data. You should not be, if you do this, the data which you have just sent will be displayed in the URL. Like anyone can trace it and fetch it. So those information you never send in get in query parameters, but all the get things you can specify. So they have provided you a mechanism to filter out the results using query parameter. Will all API provide it? No. Only this API is providing. Okay. So when you're in an interview and someone asks you, you can answer this. In our API, we have query parameters where we can limit the users. You can tell these scenarios. If you are explaining this 20 scenario, which is already there, you're through. Getting it? And good thing is this API is a very good API. They are giving you everything which you need to test. Right? So you can test like, limit is one, right? This should only return one. So what you can check is this tag is value as one, and here you see only one product. So what you can do, you can fetch all the IDs, and you should see only one ID will be there, because this is an array. Because again, I'm not explaining how JSON is, how JSON looks. Please go and read about it. But this is an array of objects. So inside data, you see an array of objects. This is an array. This is an object. So in this array, there will be only one object. Come on. So here there will be only one object, and this array is closed. Only one object is there. That is ID 43900. You can validate this limit, right? Then skip to the 25001 result. Again, a mechanism by which you can, you know, skip few of the data, few of the products. Sorting, ascending order, descending order. If you write this in a query parameter, whatever you're getting. Now this is interesting. Why? How you will validate this? Right? So what you can do is, you will fire it. By default, it will give you limit as 10. So it will only give you 10 products. And if you check whether only 10 products are coming in descending order, you can somehow imply that yes, the functionality is working. What you do is, as soon as you get the result, you will fetch all the prices. When you do price search, all the prices will come in a list. So I'll tell you how to do that. It's called a JSON path. Using JSON path, you can write the JSON path and it will give you the list. The way we do it in find elements. As soon as you get it, you will get a list of elements, strings, or integer in this case. Then you need to apply logic there to find out whether the list which you have is in a sorted manner or it is in descending order or not. Right? then you have to Google how to find out whether a list is sorted or not. I even Googled it. So one way is like you will iterate it, right? And then another way is there is a different mechanisms, comparator, iterator, different mechanisms are there. And there is one more method using Java feature called a stream. This is one more mechanism. So what I'm asking you guys to Google it, right? That's how you're going to automate this scenario. This could be a little bit tricky. So here you will require some Java knowledge as well, right? Are you getting how we learn concepts? By applying them, right? So if you do this scenario, you will learn Cucumber, you will learn API, you will also learn sorting, you will learn list, you will learn JSON path. So in a single test case, you learn a lot many things. That's the only reason you can crack an interview. Otherwise, end of story. Okay?
Actually,
Yes. This is key. See, in JSON, everything is in a key value pair. Now, key has to be always a string. Value can be Boolean, string, integer, array, objects, or array of objects. This is a key. Value. Key value. Key value. This is a key. Now, this key's value is an array. Array of objects, because this represents object. This represents array. You know what this is, string, integer, right? Getting it? So this is an array. So this is a key. This is an array, and this contains how many objects? This one object starts from here, and it will end here. Then comma, next object. Then next object, comma, next object. So this is an array of objects. All right, cool. Okay, so it is giving you all the, these are actually your scenarios. So see, show the name and price only. So I don't want all this detail. All I want is name and price, right? So you could have to put validations that whatever you're returning, it only contains name and price, right? And I have written the scenarios in such manner only. So if I go here, what you see here right now, no, I spent like half an hour yesterday and created this. Right, and I have structured it this way only. So see, so get all products but only show the name and find the result. That's the scenario name. Best Buy API is up and running. When I hit URL with query parameter as this, then API returns the response with status code as 200. Product list should only contain name and price in the response, right? Actually, I should have done this. Right, so that I could run the same scenario for some other filtering. So instead of name and price, let's say I want to only look for a description or something else, I will just put description that there, and I can use the same steps there. Getting it? The importance of it. Now it is now saying I'm not able to find the step definition for this. Right? How to change it? I'll go to this particular statement. I'll go here. Right, this is the statement. And this name, I will say string. It has to be small, okay? This price is also, I'll parameterize, I'll call it string. And here I will mark it as string argument 1 comma string argument 2. Done. You can at runtime also you can modify these statements. Getting it? Now you will still say why it's not coming. I have to close all, refresh, and then it will come. Getting so far? Right. Let me go back. So these are your statements. What you guys have to do is you need to automate all of these. You need to know how to write the logic. So idea is simple. You will hit it. You will get the response. You will fetch the data out of that response. And then you will write a logic to put a validation. Simple. It's very, very easy compared to what you've done so far in Selenium, which is really tricky. You have to do a lot of things to manage your test case to be, you know, running at all times. like different pages, objects, and synchronization. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. Screenshots. You have to manage a lot of things. In API, you don't have to manage many things. It's very straightforward and simple. Okay? So it gives you around how many? I don't know. At least 20 scenarios. So next time when we'll meet, right? Before that, I want everyone, at least whoever is in this class, should be able to complete it. And I will be available online. I will keep on enhancing this framework. You also keep on doing things, and I'll keep on pushing my changes, and you keep on inculcating those changes in your local frameworks. Okay? Right. Let me go forward. So the next concept here is how will we write those steps, right? So right now I'm going to automate a simple feature file called as API health check. Let me automate this first. Okay. Here things are pretty simple. Given Best Buy API is up and running. When I hit health check URL, API returns the response with status code as 200. Okay. Now it is able to find the step definition for this, but not this. Where is the step definition for this? Right. It is where I have just stored it. Right. Now it is not able to find step definition for I hit check health check URL. So what I do is, where is it? Sorry. So I will go, I will be able to create it. Okay. So I'll go here. I'll write here, public void hit health check URL. Sorry. Huh? That's fine. You can give any name to the method. Method name need not be same as the statement. What matters is whatever is at the top of it. That is what matters. Puchna bhai. Can come again? Right. You are asking from where these files are coming. This is API function. API acts as a black box. All you should be worried about is what API is returning. You should not be worried about from where they are coming. By the way, you should be worried about that as well, because you might have to do some more validations. But the idea is this is an application. So I'll draw it. Okay, I'll draw it for you. This is a database. All these values are present here in a tabular format, in tables, database tables. This is your API. This is you. You want to access values present here, but you cannot access it directly because this is your server. This is you somewhere. Over some internet or some network, right? Now the funda is you need to fetch values out of this database, but you cannot directly. So API developer created this API. So you will trigger this API via this network with some request like these. It will go and fetch the values out of here and it will return you in a JSON form.
Okay, so only my responsibility like to navigate anything,
yes.
Only validate check is coming or
correct,
not.
Correct. So in API testing, what you check is only the response, because that is the end customer, right? Just a black box. API acts as a black. API is an interface for you, in some sense. Interface means you are interacting with API. You are requesting API to do something for you. API will do it and give the result back to you. Right, in whatever format, JSON, HTML, CSV, text, whatever format, irrespective of it is a SOAP or REST, it returns data to you. API returns data to you based on the request which you are making. And that's the only thing you should be worried about. Got it? So I've created this. As I said, this is the only thing which matters. There are a few regular expressions which you can put here, rather a lot of regular expressions which you can put here. The simplest one is caret. This is called as caret symbol. This is called as dollar symbol. This is used to indicate this is the exact line I'm going to map it with. Okay. If anything written at the beginning, anything written at the end, it will not be mapped. So the exact line will be mapped. Okay. Now here, now let me start writing our rest assured code, right? So as I said, this is the, I drew this diagram, right? This is you. So this is you. This is your client, which you are using. Because you cannot directly, you are a human being, like, you cannot go into network and ask for it, right? You need something. That something can be called as client. Now client can be your Chrome, right? So when I say, and I go here, when I click on this, in this case, you see this URL being hit. So Chrome is my client in this case. So the Chrome is asking, sending the request, and server is responding to Chrome, right? But we are from automation side, right? So we might need some different tools. One of that tool is called as Postman. This is Postman. I can use this as a client to trigger it. Second is SOAP UI. I can use SOAP UI to trigger it. But since I'm in Java environment, I'm going to use different API, or rather different client, that's called as REST Assured. REST Assured does the same thing, and it will act as a client. It will hit the API and it will fetch the result. Response, it will capture the response thrown at him by the API, and it provides a lot of functionalities to parse it, validate it, assert, right? A lot of things it will allow you to do. So we are going to look at that now. Okay. So we'll start writing our No, it's not necessary, but there has to be a standard. See, I always tell you, you need to properly, your nomenclature will be very, very, you know, standard one. So I have seen people do this. This is no standard. Okay, so they are usually market standard or industry standard are like this. Either you will write like this, Best Buy API is up and running. So this is called a camel casing. Each word, first letter will be, you know, capital, or you will use underscore pattern. So don't do these kind of things. You always do it. You guys always do it most of the time, right?
It's better to use the underscore. Whenever we have to edit something, we are double clicked on the word and the word got selected.
Right. So idea is, this is longer, but this is more readable. So if you compare this with this, which one is, do you think is more readable? Of course, underscore one. So underscore one is more readable. I personally prefer underscore patterns. Got it? Remove it. Now let's quickly start writing a rest assured code. Okay. So rest assured is a library. For that, you need to add that dependency inside your POM XML file, which is here. Okay, rest assured 4.1.2 version is what I'm using as of now. Then I will, where is it? Here, right? So in the given section, I need to specify Best Buy API is up and running. Right? Actually, I was writing something else. I removed it. Isn't it? No. I was trying to invoke this API one. Validate the health of API is what I hit health check URL is what I wanted to write actually. I wrote this instead. So I'll write public void. Rather, I will say when. When I hit the health check URL, right? Got it? So let's start writing from given part. So given means when Best Buy API is up and running. So I'll start from here. So rest assured is also written in a given when then pattern actually. Right? So I'll write given dot. I'll not get anything. Right? Why? Because I need to import things. I need to import that I want to use given when then syntax of rest assured. What can I do? I can write import io dot. What's happening? What happened? Rest assured dot dot. Which one is what is the name? I forgot, huh? Let me copy it from somewhere. Not response. I think it's given only, but is it rest assured. And if I mark this as static, no, I'm making some mistake. Let me, 1 minute, let me copy it rather than figuring out what it should be. I'll figure it, copy it from somewhere from here. So it is same only, right? Dot star, is it? Okay. All right. Why I have done this static? Because if I don't do static, I will not be able to directly be able to use it. Right? So I would have to write every time like this. I would write like this, then dot given. So every time instead of writing given, I have to write complete lines here, right? That's the reason I'm making this static. Got it? Why we are doing this? Now then dot given dot. In given you mention URLs, authentications, and if you are creating a post request, then body part also will come under given, right? So given dot base, given dot base URI. Here you need to mention the base URI. What is the base URI in your case? In your case, the base URI is this, right? If this is an API kept on a network, then it will have a complete full-fledged .com or .in or .org type of server name. Right now it's on localhost, so this is what I'm going to use. I will give you a name as this, okay? Then if you say dot, it will ask me for different things. So body is also coming, as I said, body is coming as a part of given. Why? This only use is used for post, right? If you want to post something, you mean when you say post, you need to send some data inside this API. Then you will use post. Sorry, and inside using in this that post, you need to add some body, right? So just to give you a glimpse of what I'm trying to say, if this is get, then you directly hit it. That means you're not sending anything. If this becomes post, then you might have to send some information in the media section, right? Like what kind of data you wish to be created, because post is used for creation of data. So in case of post, you will always add a body. If it's not post, you will not add it. So we are right now focused on get. We're not focused on post as of now. So I'm going to use base URI. That's it, right? Dot get. So when you say get, in get, you can mention the endpoints, right? What are the endpoints in your case? Yeah, right. Slash product is one of the endpoint. Let me use this one. This will come become a part of my get. So combination of this and this will hit the server, right? And for the sake of readability, I'm going to place it like this. Okay, actually it's the same line. So this rest assured is built on builder pattern, right? Builder pattern is one of the design pattern in Java, wherein I'll not tell how it is implemented. Let's not go into that detail. But the idea is you can write the statement in a single line, right? The way actions work, you know how actions work. Actions also built on action class in Selenium, also built on builder pattern. So actions dot click dot, then again after you do dot, it returns the same object, and the same object will have the same methods, and you keep on cascading it, right? Chaining. It's called, also called as method chaining, right? So this is a chaining pattern which is it's built on, right? Why? Because in single statement you can write complete test case actually, right? So in the same statement you can hit it, you can fetch the response, you can parse the response, you can validate the response, same statement, same line, using method chain. So if you're interested, I recommend you guys go and read about it. Method chaining and builder pattern, okay? You do dot, when you do a dot, then what should happen, right? So there are multiple things which you can do here. You can write here then, when you say then or then return. When you do a then return, it returns a response. A response, it returns a response object, and that response object contains all the things which you would need to manipulate that request or JSON response actually. So I can also use then return. If I'm doing then return, then I need to call a response method. Response. And I need to do this. Right? Now inside this response dot, the first thing which you always check is status code. So get status code, int status code if status is equal to 200, then assert, you can use JUnit assert here, assert true, assert false, right? That you can try. Or instead of writing this, you can also do this. So let's say I'm not doing this. So I can, next thing which I can do is, so let me comment this out now. So if I'm not doing this, what I'll do is dot, then, then, and after this then you will get way more different methods to validate, because then is always about validations, right? So now you can write lot of things to validate, right? First and foremost, I can go and call body, right? Inside body I can enter lot of matchers. What does matcher? Matcher is a Hamcrest matcher. Hamcrest is a set of library. It comes with rest assured, and inside that you can put your validation points. Is equal, there are a lot of different methods available there. Assert that, these are different methods present in Hamcrest library which you can directly use. It's something similar to what you get in TestNG or JUnit, like assertions. So Hamcrest is a separate library dedicated for assertions. It has very useful methods. Rest assured is dependent on Hamcrest library, right? Now in Selenium, do you have assertions? No. So Selenium is, you know, usually is a library, or even in some sense an API. It doesn't give you, gives you an assertion mechanisms. It gives you mechanism to talk to HTML and all, right? But rest assured said, no, I'll come with the assertions also. I'll not only hit the, or assist the user for hitting the API, I will also give assertions packaged inside the same library. In that format, it gives you an Hamcrest. And if it's very easy to use and very easy to understand. If you see here, if you hover on any of these, right, it gives you full detail, and that's very useful. You really don't have to go and Google things out. It gives you everything, what it does, how to use it, get then see how you will do it, all the, you know, items it's giving you here. How to use get loto dot then assert that dot body contains string. Let's you want to check whether body contains some string, right? So you will going to use this. Then assert that dot body contains string. So you will check whether that particular JSON has this string or not. In the same line, everything is done. You don't have to call, right? If condition, like I've written earlier, if condition or every line thing can be done, happen in the same line. So I'll just for. Yes, after then, because after then only you will get those methods, not before that. No, you might get it, but it. Let's try. So you are asking if we get. I also doubt it because those are actually written after you use them. So let's say RASP dot. Do we have it? You have it, but you don't have those matchers here. You can get the body out of it, and maybe after that you might get something. Let's see. So here, that's how you can try it, JSON path and all. You get the JSON path. Like response is usually required when you don't want to use those matchers and validations of rest assured. You want to write your own matchers and validations, right? Then you get it in response. Otherwise, you're going to use the same matchers. So you will write then statements. When response will be needed, for example, in our case, wherein we have a requirement where we need to validate that the list is in descending order. So you might have to write a lot of code, right? So it's better you get things in response first, then apply this JSON path concept there, and then fetch all the list. So you have to do a lot of customization. When you have to do a lot of customization, which is not very readily available using rest assured matchers, you're going to get this inside the response and use it. If it's pretty straightforward, then you'd rather not do this because it's unnecessary. Yes. Right? And you use this directly. So let me write it. So dot assert that. Status code is 200. So a single line will tell you, I hit it, and status code is coming as 200. So there is a lot of ways to do the same thing in rest assured. Two ways I have just discussed, but there are way other ways to do it. Getting it? You have to explore them. Each test case which you do, you try to do it in a different manner. So that you know all the ways in rest assured possible to do it. Because when you go to interview is asking some question, he is usually inclined toward using a specific way. He will ask that question and he will expect that answer. Right? And you will start giving some different answer. So you will say, okay, I'm not agreeing or something like that. Right? Interviewer can also be a stupid person. It always happens. Right? So you need to know different ways of doing the same thing. And you'll only know when you actually try them out. You cannot know it just by reading about it or something, right? First, before try, you know, initially you try to implement this. Maybe later you can start exploring further on what are the other ways to do it. Okay? Got it so far? Right. But there's a problem here. Now let's talk about the problem. The problem is we are not using Rest Assured alone. We are using Rest Assured with Cucumber. So we need to adjust these based on our step definition. When I'm writing given, base, get, everything in the same line, it's actually given. The then part should be coming here. Hitting part should come inside hit. Then validation part should come here. This response code should, status code should come as 200. So I need to make use of these lines. I cannot just write things directly in a single line. Because I'm not using rest assured. Getting it? So I need to adjust. That is what we need to learn when we say Cucumber with API. Okay? So let me.
Actually, the single line is giving us the actual result, but we have to segregate it in different
right. lines. Right. It is giving you a single result, but it's not modular. We need to make it modular. Because next time you have an API call and where you are getting value returned as 201, you need to line the same line of code again. Right? Rather, make these methods reusable so that whatever status code is coming, you'll call just only that specific keyword or a step in your Gherkin and it will do the job. Okay?
Actually,
बेसिकली इसमें वैलिडेशन कैसे होता है, जैसे एक्सपेक्टेड और एक्चुअल डेटा का रिजल्ट अपन चेक करते हैं,
यस
सेम आई गेस,
यस
इट विल गिव द एग्जीक्यूशन आफ्टर एग्जीक्यूशन, इट विल गिव द एक्चुअल रिजल्ट,
राइट
राइट इसमें कैसे वैलिडेशन,
राइट दैट इज व्हाट आई वाज ट्राइंग टू एक्सप्लेन. When Selenium came into picture, Selenium came into being, they did not give you that mechanism. So they said, I will just tell you the data. You see how to put a validation. So we learned, okay, because Selenium is not giving you that, you said, okay, I'll do the job with Selenium, and whatever information I'll get out of that particular operation, I'm going to write my own if conditions, expected actual, I'll compare the expected actual, and like I'll do the reporting and all. Rest assured said, that's waste of time. Rest assured said, I will give you the operation mechanism as well as validation mechanisms within the API itself. So you don't have to write expected and actual. When you write then, it is saying assert that. Now assert that, what you're trying to say, no? It's part of assert that. You don't have to write actual, expected, and then put a if condition. It will internally do it. So this is the expected. And this line will give you actual and it will automatically match it. And if it's failed, it will fail. It will mark as a failure through an exception, say the thing has been failed. I was expecting 200, but 400 is coming or 500 is coming. If it's passed, it will say it's passed. Got it? So you don't have to actually, you have to come out of that mindset where you have were putting a lot of assertions. Now these assertions are by taking care automatically by assert that.
Sir, we have used for then.
Yes.
In JavaScript, then is like promises. It is used for promises. So
in JavaScript, in protector.
In protectors like then functions. Is there any particular requirement put here and working executions like synchronous or executions? Hmm. Sir, how do you spell using the dot then dot assembly?
See, when you learn something, no, there are few points which will be similar to the other tools which you are using. There are few things which will be different. So don't try to have that lens, right? That you are wearing a lens of protector and trying to see this from that lens. And you're trying to relate it with that. No, don't do it. It's a separate thing. It's nothing to do with JavaScript, nothing to do with. There could be some similarities, but don't try to kind of put both in contrast and trying to find similarity and see that's happening there. It's not a, it's plain and simple, straightforward. Straightforward is given is something used for what is given, prerequisite. Get is what your operation is. When you write then, that means you want to do some validations. That's how you do validations. Probably what you are trying to say, I'm not getting to the fullest. Probably what you're saying is perhaps some level of similarity between this. But I would still recommend, don't try to see this with that lens. Remove that lens. This is something new. Try to, because there is a lot of things, synchronization and all those things. It's not that, that complicated. No synchronization, etc. is required here. It's simple.
In this context, the given format is also
not. Right. So you will find some similarities. You will find some distinct features. But try to find it. Try to understand it with the context, what this is. This is nothing to do with Selenium, nothing to do with the protector, nothing to do with the JS. It's API call. It's rest assured. Getting it? Okay. The last thing which I want to tell is, it's already 2:10, so let's do it quickly. And the last thing which I want to tell you here is to sort it out, to divide this, right? How to divide this? This is a method. If I do everything inside a single method, the scope of that will remain inside the single method. What I will do is, I need to make it available to all the methods. Best way to do is to create an instance variable of some sort so that it becomes available everywhere. So what I do is, I'll do it quickly. So I'll remove this. Best Buy is up and running. I'm just only writing this line here. Then Best Buy is up and running, right? This will actually returns me response specification. Response specification. All right. Why cast? Oh, ah, sorry, it should be, sorry, not, sorry, sorry. It should be request specification. I'm sorry, yeah. So it is request specification. Okay. I'll give it a name as request specification, something like this. Okay. Then when I hit the URL, right? So what I want is this variable. So what I want is request specification dot get. Which part? This part. Should come here. So I want this line to be present here. But variable scope is limited. So I need to make this as a instance variable. So I'll keep this at the top. Okay. Done. Now, once I do this get, I'll get a response, isn't it? So I'll get a response. I'll say RESP. Right? And in the when part, I search response status code. Right. Then when it's done, and in then part, I need to validate whether status code is 200 or not. Right? So I would need this line. Response, so let me put here response dot get status code. I would need this string status code actual. Okay.
Okay.
So I am in a hurry, so I am kind of I will move this inside here. Okay. Got it? And same thing I have to do with this as well. Sequence is mentioned here, dear. Sequence is here, right? Sequence is here. Those are method calls. Okay. Got it? Actually, the test case is wrong. The test case was about health check, API health check. So best buy API is up and running. I have done. I hit the health check URL. Health check URL is where? This is the health check. So I have to trigger only this much. Okay. So if URL is this, and when I hit health check URL, which is actually this, then API return response code with status code as 200. So status code is this. So I can now put what you were suggesting earlier, like if condition status code is equal to 200, then some genuine assertions which you can put, or let me see if I can try writing something else. So instead of this, can I get status code return. Can I try with then dot assert that? So I can try with this as well. Okay. Dot status code in expected status code. Expected status code as 200. So I don't have to write this actually. Neither I have to do this. Fair enough. Looks good. Huh? Let's try to run this. Yes. So this was my file, which was run sample. Which was the file? This is the file, right? No. I'll write it here. API. GALTH health check. So I want to run this file. This is the step definition where I have kept it. Plugin, no plugin, but I need to put some plugin because plugins are required for usually for report generation. If I just run it, no report will be generated. I want the report to be generated in HTML format, right? So I will write here, pretty. This is for HTML file. So let me copy it directly quickly. So I'll just copy this. My new test. And this is, I will say false, because now I don't want to dry run. I want, actually want to run it, right? So I will say false, right? So now what will happen? Inside target, there is a folder called as cucumber results. Inside this, there will be a result in HTML format. Let me delete it for now. Okay, now let's run it. So I'll go here in new run test, right click, run as JUnit test. Executed. Result passed. Now go and let's go and check inside. So there are no cucumber results as of now. You have to refresh it. Same like you have to do when you run something in TestNG. So I'll go here and put a refresh. Then I see cucumber results. I'll go to index, right click. I'll open with the web browser. And is it my result? No. No, this is not the result. No, this is not the right result. It ran something else, I guess. What did I run? I run this file, right? API health check, step defs. API health check has these steps. Huh? That could be no right. Why is it running? Let me run it again. Yeah, come on. Fresh. And it actually ran it, but it ran something else. API health check, my new test, API health check, this. Yes. See, it is running the right file, right? Health check, where the health of the API, API health check feature, by API, hit API check URL, right? That's what it ran. You can check here as well, where the health of the API. If I go and check here. I think last time by mistake something else got executed. Okay, got it? Cool. Okay, now there are a few more concepts which I'll not as talk about as of now. I have another talk to take. Okay, now what I would ask you to do is, let me close all of these. Uncomment this file, fetch products, right? See, this is what I was talking about when I was talking about sorting it out. Try this. This is a Java 8 feature of sorting and then comparing using stream library. Okay. So here, in this case, what I've done here is same concept I applied. Okay. But few more things. So same concept of this. Now there is a concept called a scenario. Right. This scenario object is you can use it for logging inside the report, right? So right now, if you see the report looks pretty straightforward. Where's the report? Yeah, with this one, right? For example, even if I look at it, it's just statements here. Now, what exactly happened beneath these statements are not present here. If you want to type it, let's say you want to pass that customized message, you need to take help of scenario object. So scenario is an interface given to you by Cucumber. It has many methods which will give you the status of the scenarios. But right now, what you can use it for is scenario dot write. So when you do scenario dot write, so I've used a scenario dot write everywhere. See all the statements scenario dot write. When API gets product like this, right? I've written everywhere. This is required for printing the response or printing the information inside your HTML report. Okay. And later we can also try using extend report inside this. This is going to be a long initiative. We're going to learn a lot of things the way we are doing for other frameworks. We are going to automate a lot of things inside this, as well as we'll keep on enhancing it. So I tried implementing extend report as well in previous framework. And you will also see some glimpse of it here. Perhaps in, oh, I deleted that. I deleted target folder. It was there actually in the logger section. Sorry. Yes, it's something like that. Reporter.log kind of thing. Right? Moving forward, we are not going to use this. We are going to use extend report. But for now, this is also it's fine. So I don't want you to get involved in the extend report complexity. Because you will not learn anything. You will only stuck in one thing. Forget the extend report. This is also a good report. You get to see all the scenarios, what happened, and all those things you can manage very easily from here. Don't have to unnecessarily go to extend report. And you can even say, okay, what is the thing which you want to improve in your framework? I want to implement extend report. That's not there. We are still relying on Cucumber reporting, right? It gives a prepare by not implementing extend report is an answer to one of the important question. What is the challenge you are facing? Okay, getting it? And last concept here is dependency injection. For this dependency injection concept, I actually included Pico container here. It has some significance, which I think is, I cannot explain it today because it's already past two. And it's tricky as well to some extent. And you will only understand it when you face that challenge. Without you facing that challenge, which Pico container dependency injection solves, you will not be able to comprehend it to the fullest, right? So just for a glimpse, it is used to pass data from one step definition file to a separate step definition file. It's only used for that purpose, okay? It's similar to what we discussed in TestNG yesterday. In TestNG, we have native dependency injection in the form of ITest context, right? It's similar to that here. So here, there is a class file which I created, and this class file, I am injecting at runtime. Where I've created this? Here. I created this class file. It has some maps. This is used for storing some objects. And that object I can pass across different step definition files at runtime by using constructor. This is called as dependency injection. Why I'm telling you this now, I want you to read about it so that when we talk about it later, you understand what this is. Perhaps I also tried to record a video on it and I will post it on YouTube. Because after today, I think it will be 15 days, we will see each other again. Because Diwali is coming between and it's going to be like long break. Next Saturday, Sunday is going to be off, right? All right. Any questions? We're done.